Can you see my slides?
Yes, sir.
Okay, but I feel, yeah, that is the, yeah. So I'll be talking about neuroendocrine tumors for the therapy. So we all know that the neuroendocrine neoplasms are extremely heterogeneous group of a neoplasm with a distinct histological pattern and endocrine metabolism. Just a minute. Okay. So they are relatively rare and slow growing, but they carry a good prognosis. And most commonly they occur in the gastroenteropancreatic system and the lung. And however, the diagnosis and the treatment in the early stage is always challenged. So we have a WHO classification of a neuroendocrine neuromas. And in 2017, the classification has changed from the previous one that was given in 2010, where the grade 3 tumors, which were earlier labeled as a neuroendocrine carcinoma because of the high Ki-67 index, but they told that they found that there is a subset of a patient which can have a high Ki-67, but they still behave in a better manner, or they are well-differentiated tumor. So that has a more prognostic implication, and we can decide about the treatment. So coming to the neuroendocrine tumor patient, we need to have a diagnostic evaluation of the patient with the help of a histopathology. We need to have the phenotype markers, Ki-67 and other markers, whatever that is there. And we need to have imaging in the form of a somatostatin receptor, FDG, PET CT, CT, MRI, and ultrasonography. And along with that, we need to have a biochemical marker. Once that is done, we can go for the treatment, and treatment can be either a systemic treatment or a local treatment. Surgery is always a definitive treatment for a neuroendocrine tumor. However, if the surgery is not possible because the patient has become inoperable or patient has a widespread metastatic disease, then we can think of giving a somatostatin analog in the form of octreotide and lanreotide, which are basically first-line treatment therapy. Apart from that, we have other therapy also, but I'll be concentrating my talk on the PRRT, that is a peptide receptor radionuclide therapy. So whenever we plan our patient for a therapy, we always take a score that is known as a Kranning score, and it is based on the imaging, though it was, when it was devised or developed, it was based on the octreo scan, but it's still relevant in the gallium dotatate scans. And we see when the score is 3 and 4, what does it mean? Means 3 score means the lesion uptake is more than the liver uptake, and 4 is the lesion uptake is more than the spleen uptake. They are the ideal candidate for the PRRT treatment. So apart from that, it has been shown that the neuroendocrine tumors have a tumor heterogeneity. So always whenever we are planning PRRT, we always ask the patient to undergo FDG PET also, because it has been shown the lower grade tumors with the Ki-67 index 2 or grade 2 or grade 1, they'll be having a more SSTR evident lesions or disease in comparison to FDG PET, which would be high enough in the grade 3. And there the SSTR expression would be low. So these have an implication in the treatment for as far as the prognosis is concerned. Patient selection can be made better, treatment option and follow-up can be done easily. So we have a NETPET score which divide the patient according to the SSTR positivity and the FDG positivity or negativity. And P0 means where the even the SSTR and FDG doesn't show any uptake, but P1, which where the SSTR expression is high in comparison to FDG, or FDG is negative. P2 means where the SSTR and FDG both have a positive and positive uptake, but the FDG uptake is less than that. These P1 to P3 are the ideal candidate for the PRRT, while P5 is not the ideal candidate for the treatment with the PRRT. So what are the radionuclides which are used for PRRT? At present, most of the studies are being done with the lutetium-177, which is a basically beta emitter, and its energy of 497 MeV, 0.479, MeV is suitable for treating the tumor, and it has a gamma energy which is helpful in imaging also. Apart from that, initially people used yttrium-90 also, but because of its high energy and high tissue penetration depth, though it gave a very good results, but in addition to that, more nephrotoxicity was found. So people started favoring the lutetium 177. Apart from that, recently actinium 225 has also come into the horizon. Basically, it's an alpha emitter, and because of its high energy and short penetration depth, it resulted into more cell killing because of the DNA double strand break. So people are now treating the patient with the actinium 225 also. So apart from radionuclide, we have a chelator and peptides. Here the DOTA is a chelator, or it is a coupling agent which binds the
receptor.
It binds the radionuclide with the peptide, and normally is the dotatate which is used. And it has been shown that the 6 to 9-fold higher affinity for the somatostatin receptor 2, which is normally overexpressed in the tumors than the dotatate. And there is no or minimal affinity for the somatostatin receptor 3 and 5. Yeah. So coming to the PRRT, here the radioisotope is bound to ligand with the help of a chelator, and that is going to target the somatostatin receptor which are present on the cell membrane. We have 5 different subtypes of a somatostatin receptor from 1 to 5, and there would be high expression of a somatostatin receptor 2 in a neuroendocrine tumors. It has been shown that the small peptides is ideal for the imaging as well as for the therapy, and somatostatin receptors can select the patient for a PRRT using either lutetium 177 or yttrium-90 peptides. And it has been shown the patients who are showing a higher expression of a somatostatin receptor before therapy, they'll show a better response to the treatment. So there are certain list of the tumor which shows a higher SSTR expressions, like gastroenteropancreatic tumors, like carcinoid, gastrinomas, insulinomas, glucogonomas, VPOmas, pheochromocytomas, paragangliomas, neuroblastoma. All these tumors where the expression is high, these can be treated with the PRRT. So coming to the PRRT, basically once that radiopharmaceutical goes and get attached to the receptors, they get internalized, and by retention of the PRRT or radiopharmaceutical within the cells will deliver the cytotoxic radiation to the tumor. And normally the patients selected for the PRRT are those who have a progressive disease or who have an inoperable or metastatic disease, or patient having an uncontrolled symptom despite having a other type of a treatment. So it has been shown that the ideal candidate for the PRRT are neuroendocrine tumor grade 1 and grade 2, or tumor overexpressing the SSTR expression. So coming to the criteria for the selection of a PRRT, the patient should have a proven histopathology, patient should have undergone a gallium DOTA knock, or if gallium DOTA knock PET CT is not available, it can be done with the technetium 99 labeled Hynek TOC. And whole body imaging is required. In addition to that, we need to have a SPECT imaging also. Patient should not have received combination chemotherapy for last 6 weeks and no somatostatin analogs for last 4 weeks. Patient should have a normal hemogram and all these things. Platelet counts and all, they should be adequate. And creatinine levels should be less than 1.7 milligram per deciliter with the creatinine clearance more than 50 ml per minute. Now the people have just come down to 40 ml per minute also. And normally we assess the GFR with the help of a technetium DTPA scan in our department, as it is being done all over the world. And biochemical markers, if they are there, that would be good. And the Karnofsky performance score should be more than 60. So coming to the treatment protocol, normally patient is given IV antiemetic in the form of an ondansetron and dexamethasone. Patient is asked to have an adequate hydration in the form of a fluid and all this thing. And patient is given IV infusion of aminoacid, and we prefer lysine and arginine, which are positively charged aminoacids. 25 gram of each is given 30 minutes before the radiolabeled peptide administration. And this aminoacid infusion continued for at least 4 hours afterward. Basically, these aminoacids, they prevent the uptake of a PRRT in the proximal convoluted tubules. So they try to reduce the toxicity of this PRRT to the kidney, because kidney is the critical organ for the PRRT. So radiolabeled peptide infusion is given after half an hour of starting the amino acid, and it is given over a period of 30 minutes. post-therapy whole body scan is also done to see the distribution of the tracer into the body. So in this therapy, here what we see we can treat, and what we treat we can see that also with our imaging. So coming to the lutetium dotatate, normally 150 to 200 millicurie is given per cycle, and normally 4 to 6 cycles are given, and the interval between two cycles is 6 to 10 weeks. In our department, we follow a protocol of 8 weeks. And there are certain risk factors for the nephrotoxicity, like if patient has received prior chemotherapy or patient is suffering from diabetes, hypertension, cachexia, then the chances of a nephrotoxicity would be high. And it has been shown with the PRRT, the toxicities are mild and they can be easily taken care if adequate renal protection has been done or fractionation has been taken place within the treatment cycles. So coming to the adverse effect of the yttrium and lutetium-based PRRT, as I have already told you that the kidney is the dose-limiting organ, though it is less with the lutetium, but it is higher with the yttrium, and it has been shown in spite of giving a renal protection in the form of an amino acid infusion, there would be decrease in creatinine clearance, and it has been shown yttrium 90 can result into 7.3% fall in the creatinine clearance per year, while lutetium, it is just half of that. Apart from that, patient may have acute side effects like nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and all these things. And it is shown that most of the adverse effect, acute effects are because of the amino acid infusion, and they normally are self-limiting and they go away with the treatment. Sometimes the patient may have acute hematological toxicity, which is normally mild and transient in nature. Late serious side effects have been reported like myelodysplastic syndrome in the different studies, and it is it might be 1 to 2% in the patients. Apart from that, patient renal insufficiency can be there, or serious liver toxicity can be there. So NATR1 trial, which is a landmark trial, and after that trial, the FDA approved the PRRT with lutetium in a gastroenteropancreatic tumor. That was an international multicenter randomized control trial where the aim was to evaluate the efficacy and safety of the lutetium dotatate plus octreotide 30 milligram versus octreotide 60 milligram in a SSTR positive advanced midgut neuroendocrine tumor who were already progressing on the octreotide therapy. Here, 160 patients were kept in the study group, and whereas 130 patients were kept in the octreotide group, that was a control arm, and the primary endpoint for that was a progression-free survival. Secondary endpoint were overall response rate, overall survival, safety, and health-related quality of the life questionnaire. So in their interim analysis, they showed that in the dotatate group, there was progression-free survival in the 62% patients in 20 months, while it was just 10% of the patients showed a progression-free survival at 20 months. Similarly, overall response rate was quite high, from 13%, while in the control group, it was just 3%. And overall survival has shown that in the dotatate group, 14 deaths occurred, while in control groups, 26 deaths occurred. Apart from that, the grade 3 and 4 myelosuppression in the form of a thrombocytopenia, leukopenia, or neutrophilia, less than 10% patients showed that toxicity. However, in the control group, none of them showed that toxicity. And we can see dotatate group had shown a progression-free survival far better than the patient who were on a control group in a Kaplan-Meier study. Similarly, overall survival rate was also better in a dotatate group. This is a meta-analysis where they have shown the role of the PRRT in the treatment of a neuroendocrine tumor. They collected 18 studies with around 2,000 patients, where the patient received 4 cycles of a lutetium dotatate. And out of that, 11 studies with the more than 1,200 patients using the RECIST criteria showed that the pooled disease control rate was around 30%, and the pooled disease control rate was 74%. When the patients were evaluated with the SWOG criteria, 6 studies with 800 patients showed a disease response rate of 36%, and disease control rate was 81%. And we can very well appreciate with the forest plot chart also. So this is one example. We started our PRR team PGI way back in September 2012. This is one of our earliest patient who presented with the widespread skeletal liver mets post surgery, and patient showed a intense tracer uptake in the gallium scans, and in the transaxial images we can see the upper panel is showing a SSTR positive relay lesions, while the CT is showing hypodense lesions, but FDG didn't show any uptake. And this is a post-therapy scan. We can say after four cycles of a PRRT, patient showed a significant resolution with the treatment, and patient was alive for around 4 years after the treatment. This is another case of a 53-year-old female patient with a neuroendocrine tumor of a head of pancreas. Post-surgery, patient underwent both DOTA scan also, and we can see there are multiple tracer avid lesions in the liver. Again, in the FDG PET also, we can see there are same lesions are there. And when we treated that patient with the four cycles of a lutetium PRRT, patient showed a significant resolution of those lesion, and patient is on a follow-up, on a regular follow-up. This is one interesting case I would like to show. We treated first a 14-year-old boy with epigastric pain, vomiting, diarrhea, and weight loss. His serum gastrin levels were 8,000. He was a histologically proven unresectable primary lymph nodal gastrinoma with liver metastasis, which were detected on the DOTA-NOC PET CT. Patient received 5 cycles of a PRRT. At that time, even we were not sure how much of a dose should be given to the patient and all these things, but it was given as a cytoreduction. After that, the patient underwent a surgical resection of a residual mass, which resulted into the complete response with a follow-up of 4 years. Now the patient has stopped coming to us because he was really tired of coming to the hospital, but he's still alive and he's doing good. He's involved in the agriculture occupation. So this is the image of that patient. Upper panel is showing the MIP image showing the primary disease as well as the multiple liver lesions. And we can see those lesions on a follow-up scans. We can see over here, they have shown a resolution over a period of a time in the interim PET. And then in the post-operative PET, there is no lesion in the patient, and his serum gastrin level also came down from 8,000 to 49.6 picogram per ml. This is one study which we undertook in our department and we recently published, where the role of a PRRT as a first-line treatment in the inoperable or metastatic neuroendocrine tumor, we tried to evaluate. And here we took 45 patients having a grade 1 to grade 3 disease. All type of neuroendocrine tumors were involved in this, and patient had a widespread skeletal metastasis in the form of a lymph node, liver, skeletal, and lungs. And we can see that majority of the patients showed partial response or stable disease. Only 6 patients showed a progressive disease, though none of the patient had a complete response. And in some of the patients, the lesions were non-measurable, so we couldn't evaluate. And in 3 patients, they were lost to follow-up, so we only evaluated 40 patients. This is one patient or one example of the patient who underwent PRRT as a first line of a treatment. And we can see the patient had a duodenopyloric neuroendocrine tumor with the liver and mesenteric and retroperitoneal lymph node metastasis. We can see this is a pre and post treatment scans, and there is a significant reduction in the size and avidity, and patient is on an annual follow-up with a stable disease, and she is not requiring any, he's not requiring any additional treatment. So in that study, the Kaplan-Meier curves for the progression-free survival and the overall survival showed that the patient median follow-up was of 34 months, and 10 patients experienced progressive disease, 3 patients died out of that, and the median progression-free survival was 48 months in our group, and median overall survival was 84 months. This is another case where PRRT was used in a metastatic mediastinal paraganglioma. We had a 27-year-old wheelchair-bound male patient who presented with the pain in the right hypochondrium and low backache. MRI of the pelvis showed a disc protrusion of the L4 and L5 and L5 and L6. Chest X-ray done outside showed a posterior mediastinal soft tissue mass. Histopathology from the paravertebral mass showed a paraganglioma. Patient was treated with the lutetium dotatate and low-dose capecitabine, which is used as a radiosensitizer. 4 cycles were given at a 4-week intervals. The serum chromogranin levels initially was 15,000 or more. It came down to 2,300. KPS improved from 80 to 50. There was a significant improvement in the quality of life. And patient started walking on his own during the treatment. However, the patient died after 12 months of initiation of a PRRT. And these are the images we can see. The first image is FDG image, where we can see there is an intense tracer uptake in the mediastinal mass, as well as in the left iliac with a soft tissue mass, and multiple skeletal lesions are there. Similarly, the DOTA scan is also showing the concordant lesions over there. Patient received 4 cycles. This is an interim PET where patient showed a significant response. However, at the time of a 4th cycle, patient had a widespread metastasis or recurrence of a disease, and patient died 3 months of a last PRRT cycle. This is just an example of a tracer distribution in the lutetium PRRT post-therapy scans, and we can see a tracer is going to the lesions over there. From our department, a systemic review and meta-analysis was done for a role of a PRRT in the advanced pheochromocytoma and paraganglioma, where 12 articles with the 200 patients were included, and they showed clinical and biochemical response in 61 and 64% of a patient, and minimal treatment-related adverse effects were there in the form of a neutropenia, thrombocytopenia, lymphopenia, and nephrotoxicity. And 5 patients had to discontinue the treatment because of the toxicity. And this forest plot curve showed that the overall response rate in those patients were 25%, and the disease control rate was 84%. This is another indication which we did in our setup, is a medullary thyroid carcinoma. We all know that the medullary carcinoma, they are usually treated with the surgery, but once they come back or they show a recurrence, we don't have much to offer them. If those they show a somatostatin receptor positivity, we can treat those patients with the PRRT. And in our setup, we treated 8 patients who were inoperable or metastatic medullary thyroid carcinoma, and they showed a tracer uptake on a gallium DOTA-NOC PET CT. Median age was 47, and the median cumulative dose in the 8 patients was 20.9 gigabecquerel. 4 patient, 2 patient received 4 cycles, 2 cycles, and 1 cycle, along with the oral capecitabine with each cycle. It is normally we give it from day 1 to day 14. And out of 7 patients, 1 patient lost to follow-up, so we could evaluate only 7 patients. 6 had a stable disease and 1 had a progressive disease. But the molecular response on the gallium dotatate scan, 7 patients all showed a stable disease or a partial response. And there was a reduction in the calcitonin in the 3 out of 5 patients. And there were minimal treatment-related adverse events like grade 2 anemia in 1 patient. 1 patient died at 24 months, while 6 were still alive at the median follow-up of 34 minutes. And median overall survival was not reached at the time of compilation of this study. And this is one example where we can see there is a parapharyngeal mediastinal lymph node metastasis over there. And the patient had a calcitonin of a 304. Patient received PRRT as well as capecitabine, and patient showed a significant reduction in the uptake as well as in the size of the tumor. So what are the ways of increasing the therapeutic effect of a PRRT? Either we can combine the radionuclide labeled SSTR for optimal effects, like duo PRRT. Basically, it's a sequential administration of a lutetium 177 and yttrium 90, or it can be tandem PRRT, where the concurrent administration of a 177 lutetium and 90 is there. Basically, I have told you lutetium is very safe for giving the for in a PRRT without having a much toxicities and all these things. But it is not very useful in a large tumors and all these things. Where yttrium has its edge over the lutetium, so people are trying to give lutetium along with the yttrium so they can have a optimum outcome with the treatment and all. So apart from that, people have also tried intra-arterial hepatic administration of a radiopharmaceutical if patient is having a liver dominant disease, because we want to deliver more dose to the liver mets so it can give a better results and all these things. We can have a specific dosimetry which can allow us a safe administration of an additional treatment cycle if that is possible. Right now, people are just limiting themselves to 4 to 6 cycles and all these things. Or we can try combination of a PRRT like with other therapies like capecitabine, temozolomide and other things. Or PRRT can be advocated in a neoadjuvant settings or in adjuvant settings. So patient coming with the progressive disease, there are challenges for the managing the metastatic neuroendocrine tumor. It can be biological driven, means if the patient has a FDG avidity, it means patient is having a poorly differentiated type of a tumor. So probably there we need to have a chemo PRRT, means combination of a chemotherapy plus PRRT. But if size is an issue and all this thing, probably we can go with a combination of a DOPRRT. And people have tried 2 cycles of a lutetium followed by 1 cycle of a yttrium, and it has to be repeated. But in spite of that, sometime patient may show a progressive disease. There we can go for a alpha therapy, and now it is coming in a big way, and we have also started alpha therapy in our setup, and we have been treating our patient for last 2 years. So the future direction would be there is a paradigm shift of a treatment from one size fits all to a personalized treatment, and we need to have a genetic element regulating tumor cell proliferation, which requires additional studies, and retreatment with the lutetium 177 or actinium PRRT in relapse post yttrium and lutetium 177 PRRT patients, means once the patient has been treated and once they relapse, they can either retreat it with the lutetium or they can be switched over to actinium. And it has been shown a very good progression-free survival for a significant period. And Dr. Bal from AIIMS New Delhi have really done a remarkable job showing the efficacy of actinium 225 PRRT in a patient who have a stable disease or a progressive disease. We have also started treating our patient with the
sorry, sir. So we need to wind up so that we have. This is the last slide. I'm very sorry. Thank you.
Should I stop it? Or this is the last slide.
You can take us through it. But there are many questions for you, sir.
Okay. So this patient, 46-year-old male patient who had both FDG positivity and the gallium positivity, and we can see, unfortunately, I don't have the FDG scan, but you can see on a gallium scans, there is a widespread metastasis in the skeletal system. So instead of giving a lutetium, we thought of giving actinium dotatate along with the low dose capecitabine, because the patient has a high Ki-67 index. Patient received 6 cycles of treatment, and he showed a very good response, significant response to the treatment. And post 6 cycles, we can see there is a almost resolution of the disease, and his chromogranin level has also come down to 29 from the 185. And thank you very much for your kind attention.